Welcome to Tunis International Radio for this Tuesday edition of the English Language Program with Maestro Wafa Bouzaida for the technical engineering side, and I'm your host Adnen Chaouachi. I'd like to thank all our listeners who are active on Facebook. I was expecting dozens of questions and comments, and I have received exactly 216 emails. I'm sure you'll understand that our guests won't be able to answer hundreds of questions in 1 hour. I'll try to choose the most important ones for the former Tunisian Foreign Minister and Defense Minister, Mr. Kamel Morjane. I invite you to share your comments on my Facebook page, RTC, the English Language Program. Mr. Kamel Morjane, welcome to RTC.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. I'm very glad to be with you.
Thank you for accepting the invitation. I think it's the first time the Tunisian people listen to you speaking in English. This happens only on RTC.
I think so.
Okay. We'll be back in about 3 minutes. I invite you to listen to our first track for today, If Tomorrow Never Comes. Enjoy.
I lie awake and I watch her sleeping. She's lost in peaceful dreams, so I turn out the light, lay there in the dark.
If Tomorrow Never Comes, welcome back. It's 206 on our radio station. Wafa Bouzaida is our maestro for today, and I'm your host, Adnen Chaouachi. Our guest is the former Tunisian Foreign Minister and Defense Minister, Mr. Kamel Morjane. Mr. Kamel Morjane, it's a little bit difficult to choose the right terms to introduce you to our listeners, as you have an impressive resume. I'll probably start with your position at the United Nations, then we'll move to more recent ministerial responsibilities. So how was the experience at the United Nations?
Before the United Nations, I started, in fact, my career as an assistant professor at the Geneva University. But it was not that long, because I got immediately after an offer to join the UN, and specifically UNHCR, the High Commissioner for Refugees, as a legal advisor for the Arab world. And then I was immediately after 4 months asked to leave for Djibouti during the war between Somalia and Ethiopia. I went there to start a program without having visited even once any other program or office of UNHCR.
Really?
Yes. And I think this was the test they wanted to have, and I got immediately a promotion, and I was called back to Geneva. But anyway, I mean, I continued with UNHCR, which is, I mean, my family, and where I felt, you know, it's a humanitarian organization, and I felt at ease in UNHCR. Till 89, when I was asked at the time by the former president to come back with the idea that I would be given a job in the government. But then I was asked to take care of the new diplomats in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. This experience ended after 8 months, and I went back to Geneva.
After 8 months. Why did you go back to Geneva?
I went back to Geneva immediately after the war and the invasion of Kuwait, in order to take the to be the director for the Middle East region or the Middle East bureau in UNHCR. And of course, I was involved in the whole situation at that time in Iraq and Kuwait. This was, of course, in 1989. Then after that, I moved to Africa, which is, as you know, the most
beautiful Africa,
most beautiful Africa,
but difficult,
and the most important program for UNHCR, because the majority of the refugees in the world are, unfortunately, in Africa. Till 96, when I was again called back by the government to and offered the post of ambassador to the UN in Geneva. I was there for 3 years when Kofi Annan asked me to be his special representative in the Congo, in DRC, and to lead, in fact, I started the peacekeeping mission in the Congo, and I stayed there for 2 years, went back to Geneva as assistant high commissioner in charge of the operations till my departure from the UN, and when I came back to Tunis in the year 2005.
2005. I think I have to ask the question our listeners are expecting, or we will receive hundreds of calls. So let's start from the beginning. Why did you choose to come back and to work for the former president, Ben Ali, and the RCD? Was it a choice or an accident when you landed in Tunis in 2005?
To be honest, I think both. It was both. Both. I mean,
choice and an accident.
An accident and choice. The UN High Commissioner for Refugees resigned in 2005. The Tunisian government offered me to be the candidate for the post. We started with a group of 18 candidates from all over the world. And at the end, I was the last one with the current High Commissioner on the list. You know, when your country especially consider you to be a candidate for that post, and then of course when the other person, Mr. Guterres, was chosen, how could I then, when my government declined? I mean, as I think this is why I said it was and it was for me, of course, not easy also to stay, to be the deputy of, although he is a good friend, but still we were competing against each other, and I could not stay in UNHCR. Kofi Annan offered me to be the Commissioner General of UNRWA, the UN Relief Work Agency for the Palestinian refugees. But of course this was also another issue, because it's difficult for an Arab citizen to be the Commissioner General for UNRWA. And the choice, in fact, when I was offered the post of Minister of Defense, of course, for me it was also an opportunity maybe to work for my country, to try to profit, or to make my country profit of my experience. And I must say that when it comes to the work I have done in the Ministry of Defense, I'm proud of that, and I hope that those who have worked with me are also positive about it.
You're talking about the Ministry of Defense. I was planning to talk about this issue in the second part of our program, but I'm sure that you respect the rules of the game set by the hundreds of thousands of people who are listening to RTCE. You've probably had a great career as diplomat and UN envoy, but how does a UN envoy become defense minister under dictatorship? You know that the army encircled Lviv in 2008, and the Interior Ministry committed atrocities in the region, according to many NGOs and the media at that time. Were you aware of what was happening in Lviv at that time? Did you know about the death of innocent civilians who revolted after decades of silence in 2008?
There were victims, no doubt about that. But let me say that the army was at the contrary. The army did help in re-establishing the confidence between the people and the authorities. The army did not at all participate. I mean, it did intervene, but just to calm the situation. And I can assure you that when the army intervened in the in Omlarais, Metlawi, etc., it was really welcomed by the people.
But the problem is that some observers claim that in 2008, the army encircled Lviv to facilitate the task for the Interior Ministry.
No. Not at all. Not at all. I can assure you that I think in Omlarais, the baker even opened his bakery just to bring bread to the army, because the people felt confident that with the army there would not be any, let's say, misconduct or any, and I'm sure that if today we ask the people, certainly they will remember it in a positive way, because the army was not asked to intervene with the people, but to protect the official buildings and institutions. This was the role the army did play at the time.
And is it the same role today?
I think so. I think in general, when the Tunisians are quite positive about the national army, and they feel confident when they have soldiers around. I think it's due to the fact that we have a really a Republican army. And we, the experience after the revolution, I think showed this clearly. Mm-hmm. It's, but let's hope that in the future this will not be a problem, whatever is the situation.
So how do you evaluate your decision to come back to Tunisia and to serve the people, as you have said, but under the umbrella of the RCD party, and probably under the rule of the former
Look,
president?
I mean, I'm.
Do you belong to that family?
I belong to the Desturian, the Destur family. My father was a real militant, and he was even in jail during the French occupation. Mm-hmm. And I started my, let's say, life in politics at the age of 14, when I got my first card from the Destur. Mm-hmm. And then I continued even till I left Tunisia in 72. I'm proud of that. I have no problem with it. I think each one of us has to be considered or has to be judged according mm-hmm. to what he has done, and not because I belong to this or that political family. It's true that I would have preferred to see my country evolving in another direction. But if everybody has to stay aside or stay out of the game, mm-hmm. how could we then influence a little bit the situation? This is what I have tried to do. I think I have nothing to. I'm proud of what I have done for the during my. Time at in the Ministry of Defense, mm-hmm. and even in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, I did my best, although it was too short, to bring a new way of let's say dealing with the problems. I must say that the people in the Ministry of Defense of Foreign Affairs also should remember positively my stay with them.
Mm-hmm. Some observers claim that. The Desturian party was hijacked by the RCD. This is according to some observers and also some historians.
Very honestly, it's mm-hmm. difficult today to make a real judgment on the passage between the Neo-Destur or the mm-hmm. what was called the PSD at that time, Parti Socialiste Desturien, and the RCD. Many Desturians, real Desturians, went with the RCD, because I consider that this is a continuation. Mm-hmm. Let's not forget how was the situation at the end of the 80s, especially with an exceptional man, Bourguiba, who of course with the age and the sickness, etc., illness, the situation became very, very, very mm-hmm.
difficult.
For everybody. And there was a sort of hope, in fact, when the passage took place in a normal and quiet way. And this is why I think only few from the former PSD mm-hmm. Did not follow the RCD later. Today, of course, you have many generations, and we have to make the difference between those who have been with the Neo-Destur, mm-hmm. those who have been in the Parti Socialiste Desturien, and those who started maybe their training, political training and career with the RCD. There was a main difference between mm-hmm. the two, and which I noticed when I came back 30 years later. In the Neo-Destur, we used to have differences. We used to have opinions mm-hmm. among the people. We used to disagree with each other, and even when it comes to the leaders of the party, I mean, when you think of Ahmed Ben Salah, Ahmed Mestiri, Mohamed Sayah, Mohamed Masmoudi, Hadi Nwira, each one of them, in fact, represents an ideology for himself. I found when I came back in 2005 that the RCD was not like that. There was only one line, one speech. I was annoyed with that.
One ideology?
One ideology, in fact, one orientation. And in fact, I entered the officially the RCD in 2008.
You know that I've personally watched 3 or 4 movies about the time machine. I don't know if you believe in Hollywood movies and scenarios, or if you had to travel back to 2005, how would you react? I'll give you 4 minutes to think about the this very interesting question. We will listen to Dove l'amore all back in 4 minutes. Stay tuned, I'll be back. Dove l'amore by Cher. Welcome back. It's 2:23 on our radio station, and my guest is Mr. Kamel Morjane, the former Tunisian Foreign Minister and Defense Minister. Mr. Kamel, what if you traveled back to 2005? Would you stay in Tunisia or travel to the to Europe or to the United States and come back after the revolution?
It's a difficult, really. It's difficult to for anyone to put himself in a situation which, in fact, is just sort of going back to another environment, another situation. What I can say is that when I decided to come back, I did it with the conviction that I would be able to help my country in different ways. This is, as I said, I don't regret it. Now, if I knew that maybe the situation will develop like that, maybe my individual interest would have been, I'm trying to be honest, would have maybe prevailed. But as we say, in French we say, with les si, on ne peut pas refaire le monde. Mm-hmm. And we should not be with the question, redo the world. Mm-hmm. Let's especially think that, okay, each one of us is responsible for whatever he has done or hasn't done. And I did myself, in many occasions, presented my regrets to the Tunisian people for whatever maybe I should have done and I didn't. And let's think of the future. Let me say here very clearly, my objective is not at all, when I think of the future, personal. My objective is to help again my country as far as I can with the experience I have, and maybe with this party I have, I have taken the responsibility and the task of creating.
So let's move forward and try to understand what happened on January 14, 2011. The story that we know ended, or maybe started, when Ben Ali fled the country. Have you read the same story, or were you an active character, as some of your detractors claim?
Look, I mean, if I was active, then why they should be detractors? Because they should, at the contrary, be happy with that. What I can do is I played the role I did consider at that time as my role, and this started a few days before the revolution, by trying to push for a sort of national government, trying to especially involve all the opposition. I did say it even publicly during an interview with Jean-Pierre Alcabache. And now what happened on Friday, the 14th, I don't have a clear reading of the situation because many elements are missing.
You probably don't have a clear reading, but what is your reading? Is it the same as the Tunisian people?
I don't think that the Tunisians have one one reading. And even when I discussed the issue with people who were more or less,
close.
Close and involved. It's still very difficult, really, to find an explanation to this. And honestly, I really don't look at this in a very, let's say, a serious manner. I mean, I think in politics you have to take into account the situation as it is, the facts, and. The fact is that the former president left the country. Was it by his own decision, on his own decision, or was he forced to leave the country? did I contribute unconsciously in that, especially when I informed him that there was no longer any security in the country, including in my own ministry,
Your own ministry?
Yes. I mean, at a certain moment, around 1 o'clock that day, there was no any security in the ministry, and anyone could have come and done whatever he or she wanted in the ministry. And I had to intervene and ask for the support of especially the Ministry of Defense. And when I told him about it around 2:30, he seems, and I guess he was not playing game with me, that he didn't know about it. And he said in French, this is very, very serious. I will look at it. Mm-hmm. What did he mean by that, and what kind of influence this had on him? Honestly, I don't know. And this is why I have been always saying that we need to have a sort of confrontation between all those who have been at the time in the government to check exactly what happened really. But let's look at things positively and say whatever was the reason and whatever was those who are behind. I mean, this revolution took place, and it ended, in fact, in a better way than what one could expect.
You've probably been asked about the passports. Some yes. people claim that you sent the passports to a former president, Benali.
I did, but let me say it today, because today I feel free of saying it. It was not the case a year ago when I had to take into account the
different
factors, and especially, look, I have no pretension, but I'm a man of state, I'm a statesman. I was in the government, but more than that, I have this maybe advantage or terrible disadvantage of seeing states falling down. I mean, due to my career, due to my presence in many parts of the world, I can speak. I hope that my country and my nation will never be in this situation. But I knew Afghanistan when it was a real state. I knew Somalia when it was a real state. As you know, I was in the Congo and during, the war. I was in Rwanda during the genocide, and I saw all of this. Liberia, Sierra Leone, etc. This is why maybe I have a special sensitivity to this issue. And for me, what was important is how to save the state. And when I said that I didn't want to say who gave me instructions for the passport, this was for two reasons. One, what we did was legal, because the moment he asked for the passports and we sent him the passports, there was no any legal
procedure
against him. Thank you. And then we didn't give him a passport as president. In fact, the Minister of Foreign Affairs was the first one to give him his new title, his new status. But let me say also that I did not take the decision myself. I mean, this was done through the government and through the President of the Republic at that time. But of course, I took it on myself not to say this before the transition period, and now it's easy to say it, of course.
And you're saying this on RTC?
And the people in the Minister of Foreign Affairs know that.
Okay.
This is why there is no case against me.
Okay, we'll have a short break with music. We'll listen to Set Fire to the Rain by Adele. We'll be back after the news edition. We'll talk about the Almoubadara party and the current political situation in Tunisia and the future of Mr. Kamel Morjane. We'll be back. Stay tuned. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton said late Monday she takes the blame for any shortcomings in the handling of an attack last month on the US mission in the Libyan city of Benghazi. The end of this news edition. Stick around, we'll be back.
I'm going away, and how I wish it were so. So take this wine and drink with me. lay our misery. Say tonight, fight the break of dawn, come tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll be gone. Say tonight, fight the break of dawn.
Safe Tonight by Eagle-Eyed Cherry. Welcome back. It's 2:39 on our radio station, and my guest is the former Tunisian Foreign Minister and Defense Minister, Mr. Kamel Morjane. We've talked about the past, now let's talk about the present of Mr. Kamel Morjane. I want to ask you about Almoubadara Party, the initiative.
The initiative, I mean, I think it's, if I, I would, I, in a few words, maybe, it's central party with maybe the objectives of course we are aware of the expectation of the people and aspiration of our people. We are aiming in this party at putting into place a national economy founded on private initiative. The word initiative in itself is not just by
so it's a choice
by accident, it's a choice on the fair distribution of our country's wealth, on the balance between its various social layers or categories and regions, and on the creation of a climate of real transparency and sound governance. The party in fact has its references with the Tunisian school of how do you say it? Islah, reformist.
Reformist.
Going back to the middle of the 19th century, as well as the second element in our referential is the National Movement for Liberation of Tunisia. And this is where, of course, the relation between our party and the former Destour came. Let me be precise here. We have some who were before in the Destour party or even in the RCD, but we have also many who were not and who were even either in any party or even
so you have
in
no problem saying that members from the RCD belong to your party.
Look, let me repeat again, good and bad people are everywhere, and the issue is not to belong to this or to that. This is my opinion, and I think we have to judge everybody according to his behavior, according to what he has done or hasn't done. For me, it's, what is important is to have this party, the initiative, which wants to be seen as a modern and party, cooperating with all the moderate people, moderate parties, and working and trying to help for the future of our country, of our people.
And what is the difference between Almoubadara Al-Watan and Nida Tunis?
I don't think, in fact, let's be frank. Today, the differences between the parties are quite slim, I must say. With Al-Watan, we are, as you know, in the front now. Together, and we might in the near future even integrate or be part of one party together with at least
probably Nida Tunis.
Nida Tunis is different because Nida Tunis is in fact similar to what we want to have, because you have within Nida Tunis many tendencies, if I may say so, and. But again, even with Nida Tunis, we never know. I mean, with the what we are expecting for next year, with the elections, etc., I think that it's a duty for all of us to help our citizens in order to not to put them in the same situation as in the previous elections, and to facilitate their role by maybe having different. But a limited number of fronts and of lists for the elections. I don't exclude, in fact, that we will cooperate with all the parties who will respect us, who will consider our position, and with which we have common. Whoever, I mean, we have nothing. We are at the middle, and we will be ready to look at. But let me say, our orientation is, as I said, reformist and progressist.
Mm-hmm. It's clear. So all the political parties have been invited to the initiative of the union of the UGTT,
yes.
Dialogue initiative. So the initiative has not been invited to the initiative of the union.
Our party?
Yeah.
Of course, yes. No, we have been invited, mm-hmm. and we are represented in the meeting. Mm-hmm. And I think it's an excellent idea, excellent initiative taken by the trade union. Mm-hmm. I hope that it will go further than what has been announced the day before yesterday by the Troika, mm-hmm. And that it will bring a contribution to what we believe is needed today in our country. And I think, considering the situation in our country today, we need, in particular, a consensus, a minimum mm-hmm. of a consensus on many issues, and particularly when it comes to the program for the next year, and to make sure that we will have both presidential elections and mm-hmm. also parliamentary elections as soon as possible, and to work very hard, and at least for the National Assembly to work very hard to have as soon as possible the constitution and the election law. And I think, I hope that this initiative by the trade union will even go further by maybe making the people agree on, as I said, on a minimum of consensus when it comes to the different choices, mm-hmm. especially in the social field.
The Tunisian Prime Minister Hamad Ijbali and the President Dr. Moussa Marzouki have attended the meeting this morning.
I think the whole Troika was there,
yeah,
including the President
the whole Troika,
of the
But the problem is
Parliament.
That the leader of Nahda, Sheikh Rashid Ghannouchi, and and Mr. Mohamed Abu haven't attended.
Yes.
Do you think it's normal to have different positions between the government, the presidency, and the political parties?
Look, I regret that they were not there. I think, as I said, each one of us today has to make an effort to bring the country together, because this mm-hmm. is, in my opinion, the most dangerous thing which could happen to our people and to our nation. But I respect also the fact that by having President of the Republic mm-hmm. attending, although his own party did not, because I it's also maybe positive to consider that Mr. Marzouki is acting as a head of state, as a president, and despite the fact that maybe mm-hmm. His party and himself may not be totally in favor of that. But we need to have each one of us today acting, especially it comes to the state. When you are a statesman, you have to act not necessarily all the time according to what your party mm-hmm. wants, but according to what the national interest impose on you.
We'll have a short break with music, and we'll be back in about 3 minutes. We'll talk about the current political situation in Tunisia, about foreign affairs as well. We'll talk about Syria. So let's listen to Tina Arena, I Wanna Know What Love Is. Stay tuned, we'll be back. You will find the podcast and the video on my Facebook page, or this interview on my Facebook page, RTC, the English Language Program. I invite you to join me, and don't forget to click like. I'm expecting your questions and your feedback. So how do you evaluate the current political situation in Tunisia? Are we on the right track? This is the question. M. Imen from Nebel is asking this question. So she has a second one, which is a very important one. She claims that you don't have the right to evaluate the situation in Tunisia.
But why in this case is she asking a question?
Yeah, I don't know.
Should I then answer?
I'm
not
sure that she's listening.
Anyway,
so just say hi to Iman from the.
I hope that we have already left this debate, and that now any Tunisian can have the opportunity to express himself and respect mm-hmm. the others. I consider the situation as serious, but certainly not critical, not catastrophic.
And where is the difference between serious and critical?
Serious, yes, we have to be serious about it. We have to look seriously to the situation and try to find solution for the problems the country is facing today.
What kind of solution?
Look, I think let's not also always look at only the political aspect of the situation. What the Tunisians are looking for today, I think this should be the main question we should ask ourselves all the time. I think they're looking for a more peaceful, more democratic, and more equal future and country. We need to confirm all this to them by especially showing that we as politicians or the political parties should show more responsibility to answer what the people are looking for. But let's not forget that what is needed today is certainly to work seriously for more equal economic and social system in order to achieve a better equilibrium between the social classes or categories and give the maximum of employment opportunities to our people. To work for a better development also between the different regions. To do the maximum, and here I think it's the responsibility mainly of the government, for more security for the people, but
Are you talking about the interior ministry, as well as the government, when I say security, we
need more security, but by respecting the law also. We have to be very careful. This is a very sensitive sensitive issue. And the last point I would like to mention is how to work for the reconciliation and non-exclusion of all Tunisians. I think this is also a major issue. Either we are today ready to build the future of this country, of this nation together, or then we will make the same mistakes which have been made in the past, and we will continue, unfortunately, to suffer from the same illness.
Are you speaking about those who have different ideology, a different vision of the political system in Tunisia?
Certainly. I think what we need today, and I'm repeating it all the time, is a minimum of consensus between us when it comes to our choices, both in politics but also in the economic and social social fields. And this is why I consider that what has been announced by the Troika is already a positive thing, and what I hope the trade union and the UGTT will bring with the meeting they have today, I hope that it will help also bringing the Tunisians together and thinking of the future, thinking of reconciliation, thinking of transitional justice, because when I'm talking about reconciliation, does it mean without justice, without questioning everybody? And I said it many times. I'm ready to be the first person to confront whatever system, transitional justice system, we will put in place.
What if you had to react about the situation in Syria?
I mean, it's terrible. I think I feel really bad about it. I think if I have to have regrets for a non-decision position in the past, I think the international community missed the train twice, in my opinion. One is that we should have done more for preventive diplomacy before.
Preventive diplomacy.
Preventive diplomacy.
I think it was possible.
I mean, maybe we would have tried more negotiation and pressure on the allies of Syria. And here, my second regret is that for my own country, I haven't changed my mind. The fact that we have taken a position immediately maybe prevented us, or is preventing us to play a positive a positive role of maybe to in order to intervene in the situation. My feeling is that, unfortunately, whatever Mr. Brahimi will try to do, he knows himself with all the experience he has. Mm-hmm. I mean, if Kofi Annan
failed
and he accepted it. But I think we were all expecting this. It was too late. This is why I said we should have certainly done much more before. And this responsibility is for all, and in particular the five members of the Security Council.
Is there a way out?
Unfortunately, I don't see it. And unfortunately, mm-hmm. this situation could continue, and the civil war will continue. It's unfortunate for Syria. It's unfortunate for the region, because no one can predict what will be, how the situation will extend, including in the neighboring, and this will be terrible. I hope that there will be a sort of, I don't know, magic.
Miracle.
Or miracle, but unfortunately, usually in this kind of situation, we don't have miracles.
Where is your message to the ruling Troika and to the opposition? You have 1 minute.
In 1 minute, to work together. We have no choice. And to find, to look in the interest of the people, in the interest of our nation, mm-hmm. and to try to find, as I said again, a consensus on what the country needs today.
Mr. Kamel Morjane, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. It was a great pleasure.
Thank you for accepting the invitation. The video and the podcast will be available on my Facebook page, RTCI, the English language program. Next Tunis update in French and the German language program. Stay tuned to the best radio in Tunisia. Stay tuned to RTCI. Bye-bye.